public forum topic is going to be resolved in order to better respond to international conflicts. The United States should significantly increase its military spending. This is a topic that is timely, important, and being discussed. It is a topic that is not well worded and is not competitively balanced. It's going to be an interesting topic. It's not going to be a topic where the ground or the literature is particularly even. And the questions are going to be if the advantages of going second are strong enough to outweigh the drawbacks of going pro. Again, the topic area is certainly up for debate. The topic itself, regardless of whether the topic is true or not, is worded in such a way that limits pro's way to win and gives con a lot of stuff they can do. Let's talk through some of the wordings, then the overall balance, then some of the arguments. So the first clause, in order to better respond to international conflicts, pro wants to pretend that really doesn't exist. They just want to talk about the second half of the resolution. Pro wants to say this is the sole purpose of military spending is to respond to international conflicts. That's why you have militaries. That's what the U.S. military does. We shouldn't be limited by do respond to this. Con teams can do a bunch with this, but some of it is unnecessary and some of it is borderline abusive. When I say unnecessary, I mean that con can win the argument, but they're generally better off just going for substance. So con can certainly say that this is in the resolution for a reason. It's there to limit pro down. Pro can't talk about benefits of military spending that don't directly translate into responses to international conflicts. That's probably fine, but I don't know if it is necessary. What con can try and do, but that's probably more abusive, is to talk instead about how the United States significantly increasing military spending doesn't matter if it reduces the total amounts of international conflicts or if it prevents a conflict rather than responds to it. And I think that you're kind of narrowing pro down more than they need to be there. And if it is an interpretation that is equally valid textually, it's not significantly more valid than the pro's interpretation, and it is significantly less fair. So I wouldn't bother trying for that on con. You have enough advantages already without it. Significantly. The word significant is in this resolution because the policy coaches who wrote this resolution did not want the resolution to contain the word substantial. That said, teams are going to define significant as substantial anyway. Not that that particularly matters because either one is best defined on this resolution in context. Pro wants to talk about in terms of results, where a significant increase is enough of an increase to get the benefits that we talk about. And we look at it that way, because pro has to defend results anyway. If you don't get any results from the spending, there's no reason to do it, and whatever the trade-off is, whatever the opportunity cost is, automatically outweighs, and you lose on that defense coupled with any minimal offense from the opportunity cost. So pro is fine with defending significantly as results, but they don't just want to do that. They want to have some kind of upper limit that they can put on that, even if it's not in their initial definition. If you don't do that as pro, you concede to con what it is. So if you say, we should significantly increase spending, and we will define significantly as however much it takes to get the job done, and con says, well, it would take double the budget to actually do what you want, you don't have to actually defend doubling the budget, because then you just lose to overstretch every round, and that's not good for anybody. Con doesn't become better debaters, pro doesn't win any debates, nobody wins. So con wants it to mean more than most proposals out there. A con team can define significant increase as not a decrease, not staying the same, and not a minor, modest, insignificant increase. That it has to be a major increase, more than what the majority of proposals are arguing for. And there's a couple ways you can math this out. So for instance, if you look at some of the common cards in the topic, O'Hanlon has a $650 billion proposal, which is described more as moderate, and the National Defense Panel has a $675 billion proposal that's described more as significant. The budget right now has gone down from its peak of $780 billion a year at the very end of Bush's beginning of Obama's term to, with the sequester ongoing, just under $600 billion, $599 point something billion dollars a year right now, which if nothing else changes and no other budget increases are improved, could decrease, and no other budgets are approved, could decrease to just around $550 billion by the year 2020 if there were no changes made to the sequester and nothing done to offset it. So if we look at those two numbers together, we could say that right now it's $600 billion. A proposal of $650 billion is described as modest, and a $675 billion proposal has been described by its detractors and supporters as significant. So significant is somewhere more than 650, but at least 675, sorry, but less than 675. It could be more than 675 as well, but it's somewhere in that range. We could easily say $60 billion is significant, or a 10% increase is significant for the purposes of this round. If there are two different numerical definitions for significant from the two different teams, they are usually not worth fighting over unless one of them is enough to link to one team's arguments but not enough to link to the other team's. There is a very clear numerical bright line. Then maybe it's worth arguing, but generally speaking, it's going to be somewhere in the neighborhood of that kind of increase. Briefly sidetracking to the U.S. military budget overall. Right now, we spend more than the next 12 countries combined. The next closest to us is China, which spends about a fifth as much as we do. Believe it's between 8 and 10% to between 39 and 40% of global military spending, depending on what sources you look at. In terms of the U.S., we spend 54% of our federal discretionary spending on the military, which comes out to, again, just under $600 billion. Compared to that, we spend $70 billion on education, which is about 12% of that. We spend $65 billion on veterans benefits, and we spend about $41 billion on international affairs overall, and $29.7 billion on science. When you look at those different numbers, it's an overwhelming part of the U.S. budget. As a matter of fact, the U.S. military science budget, the research and development of DARPA, has a $50 billion budget, which is bigger than the science budget for science. So overall, there's certainly a lot being spent on that, and a 10% increase to that would be as much or more as we spend on pretty much anything else. It would be almost as much as we spend on education. It would be slightly less than we spend on government overhead from all agencies combined, and it would be $5 billion less than we spend on veterans benefits. So overall, that is a major part of our budget with major opportunity costs that all matters. So keep that in mind when you're deciding how you want to handle that argument. Beyond that, the other thing that you want to keep in mind when you're defining this is which agencies do not qualify as military spending. Because just because money may have a military application doesn't mean it's included in the National Defense Authorization Act or as part of the military budget. So for instance, the Department of Energy has a nuclear weapons program that does not replicate existing weapons but is not part of the military budget. The Department of Homeland Security has a separate budget. The Department of Veterans Affairs has a separate budget. And beyond that, the Department of State handles embassy security, with the exception of the Marines themselves, from a different budget. So all of these are things that are not technically military spending. Aside from that, one thing that pro teams can do to even this aspect of the playing field is they can observe that no increase or even a minor increase in spending is a functional decrease as long as potential rivals are increasing their spending more. This is the equivalent of evolutionary biology's Red Queen hypothesis, the idea that you have to keep running forward as fast as you can just to stay still. Actually, staying still or going forward slower is functionally backwards motion. And if you can force Khan to defend a de facto decrease and say that significant is enough to be a net increase compared percentage-wise to other countries' percentage increases, then A, the roles become more clearly delineated, B, ground gets more even, and you can certainly say, therefore, less overall functional spending, we're for more overall functional spending. With definitions out of the way, let's talk about burdens. So the trouble is, Pro needs to show three things to win. Khan needs to beat any one of them to win, or can win in several other different ways of their own. Pro all needs to argue that A, the U.S. military needs to intervene more. B, what's stopping us from doing this effectively is that we don't spend enough on our military. The problem isn't where the budget is allocated, or a problem with strategy, or a problem with anything else. The problem is that we don't have enough money. And C, that we can actually afford to spend enough to make a difference, since spending more than the next dozen countries combined is not enough. So overall, Khan can refute any one of those, and win, Pro needs to win all of them. Also, hegemony being good is pretty much core to Pro. You're not going to see policy style AFs where the Pro team argues that we should affirm the resolution by doing something that's bad for the U.S. because it's good for the world for the U.S. to try and fail. That's not going to fly in front of public forum judges. So Pro is pretty much pigeonholed into hedge good. The trouble is that Khan teams have just as strong links into hegemony being good, and Pro has a hard time showing marginal utility. They have a hard time showing that this much more money spent creates more effectiveness, that right now the amount that we are spending is the problem rather than what we are spending it on or how we are using what we have spent on. So a lot of Pro teams might have some early success debating scenarios instead of the whole topic until Khan figures out framework, but most of these are going to become reasons to reallocate funding or to prioritize a certain conflict rather than to write the military a blank check or to increase military budget across the board. So let's talk about literature a little bit. So there's a lot of people who are writing in favor of a strong military. Most of them are Khan authors. Pro authors aren't against a strong military, but the majority of people who want to talk about what makes our military strong in the long term and how to maintain American primacy are actually arguing for either maintaining levels or for a minor increase. Few of them are arguing for decreases, even fewer are arguing for net substantial increases versus arguing for their particular pet project, whether it be F-35, Zumwalt destroyer, whatever. So some topic analyses are trying to rebrand literature for the sake of topic balance, but branding center-right offensive realists, IR theorists, as the extreme left, just because the topic would be balanced better if half the lit was for a major increase and the other 50% was split between a small increase, no increase, and the decrease, that doesn't mean that it's actually true. Most of the cards that look good for at first glance are arguing against significant cuts from the sequester, not arguing for spending more. They're arguing for maintaining spending levels for Obama's second term. So one thing that both teams need to ask themselves is, why have military successes that we've had been incomplete? Why have tactical successes not translated into strategic successes? Why have strategic successes not lasted longer? What is actually making this difficult? And if the answer is not enough money, Pro can win. If the answer is something else, Pro has to find a way to link it into, well, it's because not enough money. So overall, this topic is also very complicated by the incoming Trump administration, and there's a couple reasons for that. The first is that teams might make arguments about how what Trump is doing is good or bad for this, or having Trump as a commander-in-chief is going to change the way the military spends money if its budget is increased overall. The way we respond to conflicts is going to change. The trouble is, a lot of this extrapolation. There have been credible think tanks who have spent a lot of time, money, and dead trees doing detailed studies of the economic ramifications of Trump's plans. The trouble is you have to do a lot of extrapolation to conduct an 80-page study on the economic ramifications of a 140-character tweet. So when somebody says, let's have an arms race, bring it on, we'll outspend and outlast them all, what does that actually mean? How much does that involve spending? How much of that is producing more content we already have? How much of it is new R&D? How much of it is actually just missile defense to shut down their deterrent capabilities so only we have deterrence? There's a lot that can go into that. And it's really hard to look at a tweet or even look at some of the platitudes on a politician's website and say, okay, this is the actual budget proposal that we're going to talk about here. It's further complicated by the fact that Trump's stance has also been that we should spend less on NATO and that we should spend less on our allies in general. Spending less on NATO, he has said, will save us money. He has talked about building more ships, building more airplanes, building more missiles, but paying less for them because of negotiating better deals with Lockheed Martin, Northrop Grumman, and Boeing. So at that point, it's hard to say whether he actually wants a net increase in military spending or just a net increase in things that go boom. So where that leaves us is trying to figure out, A, what is the plan actually? B, how do we frame something that's basically another country paying for protection? If you go along with some of the previous campaign speeches during the primaries and you agree that we would be implementing a plan where we stop protecting Japan, we stop protecting South Korea, we stop protecting Taiwan unless they pay us for it, would that actually be a decrease in military spending, or the spending stay the same and they just pay us back for it? And if so, is that still a functional increase or decrease in spending? And again, it's hard to extrapolate. I don't think that your cases should rely on how things will change under a Trump administration. First off, it's too soon to tell. During the January topic, the first tournaments on this topic, we aren't going to have any confirmed cabinet positions. We aren't going to know who is actually going to be heading up which departments or what they are going to be doing, how much they are going to be micromanaged, how much freedom they are going to have to do things the way they want. So that's the first reason. The second reason is it banks too heavily on your judge's politics. You should be prepared to explain how a Trump administration changes pretty much any topic. Well, any area of this topic, any scenario, any contention, if the other team brings it up. But I don't think you want to bank on that in your own case necessarily. So as far as the pro team goes, you probably weren't talking about scenarios. Arguing about increasing military spending in the abstract for some potential hypothetical conflict is really hard to get impacts to. It's really hard to weigh, and it's really hard to humanize for a judge. This means that you want to pick particular examples of scenarios. And these scenarios can come in the forms of particular kinds of threat or particular places around the world, particular zones that either have ongoing conflicts or are likely to in the not too distant future. So some examples of those would include anything dealing with India and Pakistan, anything dealing with China and Taiwan, anything dealing with China and Japan, South Korea and Japan, South Korea and China, China and the Philippines. AFRICOM has had a 300% increase in its bases. There are a lot of emerging conflicts there that we have been deploying special operations forces to try and head off or to try and train locals in dealing with. South America's conflicts are generally dealt with more between non-state actors than through active U.S. military intervention. We actually have relatively few bases on the next closest continent to our own. But overall, it's going to be a question of the Middle East, it's going to be a question of Russia, and it's going to be a question of Eastern Asia. Because those are the main areas people talk about a pivot to in the status quo. A lot of people are going to be tempted to talk about the Syrian civil war, but I think it's a bad idea for a couple of reasons. The first reason it's a bad idea is because it's something that Russia and Iran and Syria are willing to pay for. The main reason that we would try to do it ourselves instead is if we had a different goal, because the Obama administration wanted Assad to leave power and didn't want to defer to the Russians on this. This is definitely changing. We no longer really have an incentive to do things our way instead of backing Assad and backing Russia in trying to restore the current government. So if the U.S. isn't going to do that, there's not really much reason to ramp up military spending somewhere that we dropped the majority of the 26,000 bombs we dropped this past year on anyway, and that Russia is bombing more heavily than we are. So at that point, ISIS is probably not where you want to focus. The other reason that you probably don't want to focus on ISIS, besides just that it's no longer a priority to have a different outcome to the Syrian civil war, is because the U.S. has already spent a lot of time and money on that, and unless we are willing to commit ground troops, there's very little we can do that the current sustained air campaigns are not already doing. It's not that the U.S. doesn't have the firepower to wipe ISIS off the map. It is a question of will. It is a question of goals. It is a question of logistics. There are maybe five countries on this planet that could win a war against one U.S. carrier battle group. The issue is not, does the U.S. military have the strength to win a conventional war against someone? The question is, do we have the willingness to do that, and can we afford to do that? And one thing that's going to be talked about by both teams here is the concept of perception. Pro is going to argue that if we don't continue committing to improving our military, it will be seen as an unwillingness to use the military we have, which will in turn get us drawn into longer and more expensive conflicts down the road. Khan is going to argue that you don't signal willingness by being conflict averse, but also increasing your military budget, that you signal willingness to use your military by actually using one's military. So overall, that's where the big distinction is between those, but both sides should talk about not just how this funding will be used, but how the U.S. choosing to cut funding, let funding stagnate, or increase funding will be perceived, and whether that perception is dependent on or independent of the way the U.S. uses that military. Now, Khan, again, has a lot of different ways that they can approach this topic. Generally speaking, Khan is going to have to speak first unless you're debating under CFL rules, which means that Pro will have some time to adapt. But Khan can certainly talk a bunch of things. The most intuitive Khan contention is probably overstretch. U.S. military intervention is good. The U.S. responding to international conflicts is good. Significantly increasing our military spending harms our economy and harms our ability to do that in the long term. It spreads us too thin, and it means that we're going to have backlash against us at home and abroad that reduces our ability to be the world's police in the future, to be a global superpower. So that's that. The second argument that you're going to see countries making is just offshore balancing. The U.S. is more effective when it doesn't maintain expensive bases around the world, but when it intervenes to stop regional hegemons from developing. Khan can also just argue that the U.S. being a hegemon is bad for the world, that democratic peace theory isn't really true, that the U.S.'s attempts to liberalize other countries through military force tend to fail, and that overall, this is actually going to play out poorly. You can talk about economic harms to the United States. You can talk about military waste. That's more of a defensive argument, in my opinion. Military waste being bad isn't enough of a reason in and of itself until you look at the opportunity cost of that waste. You can talk about proliferation. You can talk about an arms race. You can talk about how the marginal return on the U.S. developing its nuclear arsenal from the point that it can just blow up the world 50 times over to the point that it can end all life on the world 55 times over is less important than some other country going from enough nuclear weapons to cause an extinction-level event 0 to 1. Even though the U.S. is building 5 times as many more nuclear weapons, the amount of deterrence it is gaining is much less, and that the arms race is really a question of marginal utility for deterrence. You can argue that U.S. attempts to intervene increase conflicts. You can argue increased military spending causes conflicts to go up, that decreases causes it to go down. You can argue the trade-off with better prevention measures, that writing the military a blank check encourages us to use more military force, or that it makes us less likely to use diplomacy. Pro will argue that hard power is key to soft power, that we need to have a strong enough military for people to take our diplomacy seriously. But strong enough is really hard to define in a way that makes a modest increase not strong enough for that purpose. But the idea of a trade-off in general, I don't think is the strongest con argument. It can be made, but the issue with arguing about trade-offs on the con side is mostly you can't show those will happen, and framing them around in such a way that they do takes away from one of Kant's stronger arguments, which is to take any single pro contention and show that this is a reason for intelligently reprioritizing or reallocating military spending rather than spending going up overall. Pro teams should object to having to defend every line of the military's budget, but con teams should be able to provide evidence that shows that when the budget increases, a lot of it is going to go to pork, to pet projects, to making jobs in the districts of the senators who voted for the bill, rather than towards actually increasing military readiness. So overall, I think the three-part burden gives pro a big disadvantage. Maybe the advantage for being second is going to be enough to compensate for that. I think it might be earlier in the month as people get more familiar with what they want to do with Fram, but overall, this is a topic I would be inclined to flip con over flipping second. If you have any questions about this topic, certainly feel free to leave them in the comments. Otherwise, I will see you when we talk about February's topic. Best of luck at the January tournaments, and we'll come back to see what the other half of the topic committee does for the next month. Take care.